Expedition 44 here with Matt and Ryan. Today we are going to dive into 1 Peter. This is our second part. The first part was an introduction. We kind of went over the foundation of how you should be thinking as you read the book of Peter and some context to it. And so today, where are we headed?
So we're going to cover the first 12 verses. So it's his introduction, his beginning exhortation, and then next time we'll kind of get into the thesis of the letter, his thesis statement, and how to live that out. But yep. He's got some introductory remarks where he talks about his audience and gives some encouragement before he leads into the meat of the letter.
Now, one of the interesting things about biblical scholarship is that when we go through this, it's very easy sometimes to spend a long time on like a single verse. For instance, when I hear a topical message jumping back and forth and everything, I kind of immediately start to roll my eyes because I feel like it's kind of opening the door for a lot of proof texting and things like that. And so I like it better when you start on one thing and you work your way through, which is exactly what we do on these videos. We go verse by verse and we work it through. The hard thing about today is that, and I say this about a lot of videos, but there is just so much in these first few verses. I mean, I could probably, in fact, this week I wrote a post on 1 Peter 1 and another post on 1 Peter 2, and both of them were like books. I mean, it's like I could spend 45 minutes just on 1 Peter 1 probably going through it. So in a way, even though our what we're known for is not leaving a rock unturned, sometimes that gets difficult when there's just so much in here. Mm-hmm. So we're going to try to kind of move through it, and a lot of it we've done thicker parts in different videos, and so we'll be making allusions to go back to that video and get the long version of this if you need to. So with that being said, the toughest part of this, the one that's probably going to take the most time, are the first two verses in Peter. So let's jump into that.
All right, so this is 1 Peter 1, 1 and 2. I'm reading from the NASB. So, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who reside as aliens scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia, who are chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father by the sanctifying work of His Spirit, to obey Jesus Christ and be sprinkled with His blood, may grace and peace be yours in the fullest measure.
As we mentioned in our first book, you know, it seems funny that there's a question as to who wrote this, because off it comes off Peter, big P, big A for apostle. There's a lot of clue words going on, but we already talked about that, and we've landed that this is the Peter that we know and love, the rock of the church.
Yeah, so Peter, Petros, literally means rock or little stone or rocky, if we put it in English terms. So it was Jesus' name given to Simon. And you can read about that back in the Gospels. Upon this rock, I'll build my church, and the gates of Hades won't overcome it. An apostle with a capital A. According to Paul, an apostle is someone who's seen the risen Lord. And Peter walked with Jesus for 3.5 years and saw him rise from the dead.
Now, I write a fair amount. I write articles on Facebook all the time. We make videos. I'm in the books right now and everything else. And I tend to write long sentences, and my editor doesn't like that. And 1 Peter has some long sentences in it. And this is one of them. One and two. There's even a longer one we're going to get to after that.
20 through 12.
But there's a reason why it's one sentence and they're all together. So when I read 1 Peter 1 and 2, it's strategic that this is not broke up. There doesn't want to be any question that these things aren't related to each other. Mm-hmm. And so this isn't for, you know, topical doctrine to try to, you know, oh, this is a reference to this way back here, let's jump all over the place or anything like that. And that's why I started this film off the way that I did. 1 and 2 is meant to be read together. Why do I say that?
It's important to keep all these concepts together and not basically go proof texting what each of them means, because they all work in tandem.
Yeah.
And so it's like what we talk about, the dance of grace. There's three major concepts that he's dealing with here in the first two verses, which are being elect, being aliens, and being in the diaspora, scattered. So those three concepts need to dance together.
They're all tied in together. Yep. You can't put one of them out on an island by itself and then, you know, deal with the other two and put one this way, one that way, and send the other one that way. They're all connected.
Yeah, so the first term we need to deal with is exiles, aliens. It's the Greek term peripitomos. And It's really rare in the Bible. Actually, this is a hapax lugamenon. It's a one-word occurrence.
Yep.
It's the only time that it appears in the entire text of Scripture.
And we've had this conversation before, so this is a little bit of a different word, because actually after the time this is written, we're going to see the word pop up a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is where I come back to say, this actually might be a truly biblical word. This mm-hmm. might be one of those words that maybe 1 Peter or Peter himself invented, and then we see the early church using it mm-hmm. in writing form a lot after that. This is why dating is important, you know,
yep.
when we were talking about this. But when we come back to it, my thought is this is probably, you know, an original biblical word that we're going to see people use after that. I would challenge you to try to find it used. We put this at 62 to 65 AD, and I would challenge you to try to see it used before that. It's not, you might be hard pressed to find it anywhere. So it seems to be kind of a church topic word, and that might be important.
Yeah, so what we've kind of broken it down to, and most scholars do, is that it was designated as someone who willingly or maybe not willingly dwells in a foreign land.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
So what you often hear this is people like to call these sojourners of the dispersion or the
yeah.
diaspora or something like that, and that kind of has an escapist thought to it.
Yeah, like, this world is not my home, or this earth is not my home. I'm only passing through, that the goal of my existence is to be disembodied in heaven,
yeah,
or something
yeah.
like that. And that's kind of the mindset that some people will take here as aliens here on earth.
And it's really rooted in a lot of
Platonic
thinking. And so this whole idea that, you know, we are completely of God's realm, and that we're just simply like dancing down here, mm-hmm. you know, and then eventually we're going to be up here. I wrote a long article on this the other day, and it goes both ways. It's, in fact, it goes more the other way, that we're not quite all with God. So what you're going to be reading here is almost like a wrestling match in mm-hmm. Hebrew. It's Peter trying to work his way through of Israel feeling like they didn't make the cut and they don't belong up here. So there's a sense of alienism there, that they're aliens in God's world to a certain extent, but then the Gentiles are feeling like they're all in with God and they're aliens here. So I'm going to get into this more a little bit as we go, but there is a little bit of a wordplay going on here as well.
Yeah, and I think that there's also another plane that we can go on, is the either the sociological meaning and the spiritual meaning. So sociologically, yeah, if it's a primary Gentile audience, they would have been ostracized by their families and that, and so they would have been, even though they were resident aliens, they would literally be aliens because of them leaving the gods of and the ways of their former way of life. As maybe Jews, it could be the dispersion from Rome of Claudius in 49, and they still haven't returned back to that area, but a lot of them were sent out into these areas
yep.
that we know in Asia Minor. So they literally could have been displaced from their home in the Jewish context. So you got both of those sociological ones, but spiritually also, that they're part of another kingdom that isn't Rome.
Yeah.
Jesus is Lord, not Caesar. It's that mindset that he's also, I think, communicating. So I think these terms overlap in both the sociological and the spiritual aspect.
Yeah. This term also kind of tends to take on, I hate to say negative, but it kind of has this negative vibe of people that just haven't been making the cut. That's really what Peter is talking to here,
mm-hmm.
is that, you know, we're supposed to be, you know, if you call it sojourners, you know, that we're part of this allegiant kingdom, yet we're dabbling down here.
Mm-hmm.
And then you've got this whole idea of Israel, of people that, you know, were part of this great covenant. There was this amazing plan for them, and they couldn't have failed more miserably there. So is mm-hmm. God unhappy with them? Do they not quite fit into, you know, are they aliens of that feeling or kingdom as well?
Yeah, so in the Epistle of Dionysius, he refers to this term, and here's how he does. It says, "For Christians are no different than other people in terms of their country, language, or customs. Nowhere do they inhabit cities of their own, use a direct dialect, or have lived a life out of the ordinary. They live in their own respective countries, but only as resident aliens. They participate in all things as citizens. They endure all things as foreigners. Every foreign territory is a homeland for them. every homeland a foreign territory. They may marry like anyone else and have children, but they do not espouse them once they are born. That's expose them basically to all the corruption. Yeah. They share in meals, but not in their sexual partners. They are found in flesh, but do not live according to the flesh. They live on earth, but participate in the way of life of heaven. They are obedient to the laws that have been made, and by their own laws supersede these laws. They love one another, they are persecuted by all. They are not understood, and they are condemned. They are put to death, but made alive. They are impoverished, but make many others rich. They lack all things and abound in everything. They are dishonored, and they are exalted by their dishonors.
There's a lot in that one. So it's introducing this idea of diaspora.
Upside down kingdom.
Of the upside down kingdom, that these are going to be spread. There's a Jewish exile going on. There's this idea of Christians that are sharing these values of the surrounding world, and maybe they shouldn't be. They're intermixed. Mm-hmm. You know, originally, you got to keep this kind of in context, that God's kingdom was supposed to be like this.
Yep.
And so this spreading was a result of, I kind of had a negative illusion there, but it's a result of things that went away that they shouldn't have gone. They went amok.
Yeah, so there's, when you look at diaspora also, like in the, like you said, in the Jewish context, it was when the exile happened, the Assyria scattered the northern tribes out to the nations, and this might have been the area that these tribes have been living in for many generations.
Yeah, and we get some tip-offs there. He names a few things. What's the significance of the places that he names here?
We do see, like we mentioned in the last video, in Acts 2, all these different areas you see present at Pentecost.
Yeah, and 2-9,
so,
yeah.
Yep, and so when you have that, it can really point to the mission of the early church was to go out into this diaspora area at the pouring out of the Spirit and taking that the kingdom of God with them out into the outer reaches of the world.
So we're using some biblical language that people can identify, both Jews and Gentiles up there. It's setting kind of the course for this, that there's a little bit of contention, that people aren't feeling necessarily accepted anywhere, that maybe they're not feeling like God is completely accepting them at this point. Yep. There might be some trust issues going on there. And they're also feeling like the world has spit them out and they're suffering because of that.
Yeah, and diaspora, like you said, in the Jewish context, wasn't a good word.
Yeah.
It wasn't a good concept, but it seems that the things of bad, that God can turn them for good. And so he calls these people that are exiles and these people that are dispersed, elect.
Yeah.
Or chosen.
Yeah.
So that's the next word.
Two big punch words here.
Yeah.
And this is kind of what a lot of, you might get into like the Reformed and Calvinist camps of where they try to use this to kind of land talking about this almost fortune-telling sense that God, you know, has this sovereign, omnipotent ability to know all things from the beginning of time in every way and in all ways. Hold on to that. We're just going to work through what these words mean and why they're in this sentence.
Yeah, so is there anything in the context yet in these sentences that talk about soteriology?
It's not a book for that yet.
No,
is it going to become that? Let's find out.
We'll find out. So election and foreknowledge here are not, I don't think there's so much concerned about the doctrines of soteriology, and that's usually where our Reformed brothers and sisters go. But this is a doctrine of reassurance for persecuted Christians to encourage them not to leave their faith in the suffering that they're experiencing.
Yeah.
And so he says that in this elect or chosen, it's a theological buzzword that we have. But often what we see in the Bible, things that are elect are chosen for a purpose.
Yep. Set apart for a purpose. Kadosh is the Old Testament.
Yeah, so we see that the purpose of God's people in the Old Testament, they were chosen to be a light to the Gentiles, to fulfill the Abrahamic covenant. And
this is a picture of God taking something from the place that he was. He's meeting it there. This is not a holy word. We say that before. It's set apart to death, whatever, but God is going to take this, and he's going to change the context of the people, meeting them where they're in, pulling them in with outstretched arms, and actually even changing the meaning of the word to mean, I want you to be holy before me.
And then if you look at all these words in Greek, they're all talking about groups and not individuals.
Yeah.
So it's the elect group, not elect individuals. Now our Reformed brothers and sisters will say that God chose individuals before time. Yes, there are individuals in the group, but I would say the only elect one would be Jesus, and those in Christ are the ones who take on that mantle, I guess, the title.
You also have to interpret this from the lens of he's redefining new covenant relationship in 1 Peter. This is a book on sanctification. And so as you read this as a book on sanctification and you read other times where we see talking about the elect, you might find that in 1 Peter 2:9 a little bit later in here, 1 Timothy 5:21. They're all Old Testament references. And this is why it has this kind of Hebraic sense of writing, and some people, I would say, misget it, thinking it's talking about, you know, it's just written to Jews. He has to go there because everything is bathed first in the Old Testament. So as we read 1 Peter 2 and 1 Timothy 5, and we hear talking about the elect, you have to connect that to Deuteronomy 14, 2, and maybe even Isaiah 45 in order to get the idea that this is relational God's people.
And elect can also take on a sense of, like you said, just chosen for a purpose. And a lot of that in the Hebrew mindset goes that way. I mean, you had Cyrus, who was a pagan, who was called God's elect.
Right. How does that work?
And then you have elect cows and elect trees and stuff like that, and the sacrifices and the building of the temple. Are those timbers going to heaven? No. They were chosen for a purpose of building God's house. So it doesn't always... You can't always just go to soteriology every time you see that word.
And we're going to get to this, but I'm going to get really into this, but this is a little bit of a wordplay kind of directly in the face of antinomian Gnosticism. And so that's what's going on. And they were really into this whole idea of fortune telling and everything else. So when you describe the idea of the elect as this, you know, almost magical sense of knowing the future, that's exactly what this is alluding to preaching against. Yeah. That was what was going on in the day and saying, don't do this. Yet today in our modern culture, that's what we're doing. And it's so...
Totally Gnostic.
Totally Gnostic and totally exactly the opposite. This is a contronym, exactly the opposite of what Peter was teaching towards here.
So when we look at really foreknown... Calvinists will go to foreloved here, which I don't think is a horrible like concept for it, but they take like that fortune telling thing, but just means that God knew that before this happened, that those who follow him in the midst of the world are going to be exiles and dispersed and have trials. But that is the way of the Jesus life.
Yeah.
That he knows that the people that are truly living this out, he knows beforehand that he would have a people who were following him, that remnant, who would suffer. And that's what this is talking about. But it's reassurance that God knew this would happen and he has the power to protect them.
Yeah. So when you look at this idea of the word, it does go back to Hebrew. And again, this is one of the main reasons why I feel like Peter is bathing this in Hebraic mindset, is because this is one of those words that the word in Hebrew, there's several different ways to do this, but the one that's referenced here that would be go back there is yada, and that you're going to recognize that as meaning a lot of different things in the Old Testament. But what's interesting is if you take any reference to it, it might mean sexual intimacy, and we get that because that's the picture of the closest super intimate relationship that God's given us on earth to represent just a shadow or a picture of what he wants between us. And that's the relationship between Jesus and the church too. Yep. And so when you get this, it's this idea every time you get the word yada of this kind of relational thing. And the Stoics would put it as intellect, which is a wrong interpretation. Yeah. And so you got to think relational, not of intellect, and that's going to get you steering in the right direction. It's also interesting, I don't know if you ever heard people like kind of talk about rambling, and they'll kind of go, and he said this, da da da, and yada yada yada. You ever wonder where that comes from? That's Hebrew. You're speaking Hebrew when you say that. And it's this idea of so on and so forth. It's like this know-it-all thing. No, and so that's what it means. It's extremely relational. And so I always laugh because I actually heard, I believe it was R.C. Sproul talking about foreknowledge one time. And he said that. He goes, and yada, yada, yada. And it was like, I just chuckled because I'm like, you just pretty much said the opposite of what you're trying to prove.
Another thing is like Paul in Acts, he talks about his life as a Pharisee and how the Pharisees foreknew him.
Yeah.
It's an intimate relationship amongst that group of Pharisees that they knew each other. Like you said, relational intimacy is really what's at the heart of foreknowledge.
Exactly. And so, you know, you got to get the intellect thing out and you got to put the relationship in it. There's also something going on here with the prediction. So within, I kind of mentioned the antinomian Gnosticism, the Stoicism's going to get into this too. Magic is a big deal here. And this is also, I think, why 1 Peter is connecting exile language going all the way back to the Exodus, that we often see that linked to it. And there was a magical play going on there where you had this kind of sense of magic with what God would do. And then the other side at the Exodus was also producing the same kind of magic. And so there's this idea of this fortune-telling magic being completely opposite of things of what of God's world. And so I talk about these a lot of contronyms, that things that at front value seem very similar, yet they're not. So another example of that is that God wants us to become His, and as we follow this road of sanctification, as 1 Peter is talking about, eventually we're going to become very much like God. In fact, the thing is that Jesus lives inside me, and the goal is that somebody would look at us and see Jesus. Mm-hmm. Yet at the same time, we're not to put ourselves as God. That was the whole problem with Babel. That's the evil side of it. And so these two things look very similar. And if you really get into the Greek text, it seems to be a wordplay that Paul is contrasting between the two. Don't be that of Stoicism in terms of foreknowledge and elect. I'm talking about something different. And then he goes on to describe that.
Yeah, and if you do want to take a salvific look at election and foreknowledge here, later in the book of 1 Peter, he calls Jesus the foreknown one.
Yeah.
So he's connecting that this opening thing of foreknowledge to Jesus. And I use an airplane analogy, which I think I got from Leighton Flowers, is if you look at election and foreknowledge as an airplane, the airplane is predestined to go from, let's say, Chicago to London. Jesus is the airplane, let's say, but those who come, who are in him, are the ones that make it to the destination.
Yep.
It's not, but the pilot or the plane doesn't choose who comes in. They get the choice. You can purchase a ticket. You can respond to the call to come onto the plane, but those who are in the plane are the elect, and they are foreknown that plane will go from Chicago to London.
That's good. That's really good.
So from here, we kind of branch into, again, something that's related. It's a Trinitarian statement. And so this is what I might say is one of the most clear pictures of the Trinity. And some people, you can throw me under the bus as a heretic here, but I'm going to say a lot of people, when Paul is writing this, are still uncertain about the Trinity. If you were a Hebrew, the Trinity was a foreign concept in the Old Testament. You might have saw the Spirit and the Father God, but you wouldn't have lived in the Old Testament and saw a picture of the Trinity. That kind of thinking is going to become New Testament, New Covenant thinking, and it's probably connected with Jesus after he rose, goes up to the Ascension, and then what does he do? He sends his Spirit back to Pentecost. And so there's all kinds of ways we could get off on this and speak on many films, and maybe we'll make a film just on that right now. But this is one of the most clear statements on the Trinity. It lists all three of them right there.
Yeah, so we got all of them working in a different way that talks about salvation. So it says this happens, this is in verse 2, you see it, that these exiles were chosen to obey Jesus and to be sprinkled with his blood.
Yeah.
And this happens, it says, according to God's foreknowledge.
Yep.
And it has no mention of the Calvinistic thought of before the foundations of the earth, so
yeah,
that has to be read into it.
So it's interesting, Matt and I aren't necessarily saying that God doesn't have the power to know things ahead of time like mm-hmm. that, you know, more of the stoic sense of it. I mean, a Molinist would actually say that, you know, God can see different things and he yeah. even sees the options and yep. he kind of weighs out the options and things like
creates
that.
The best world.
That's not what this film is yeah. about. We're not necessarily going there, uh-huh. but we're not ruling out all of those ideas. Yeah. The only one we're really speaking against is the extreme Calvinist view of God knows, orchestrates, commands every little movement yeah, from every step.
Robotic.
Yeah.
I guess. So next it says it's this obedience is for and by the sanctifying work of the Holy Spirit. So sanctification is, like we said, about being set apart.
Yep, it comes down to Christiformity.
Yep.
That this is, we're going to be set apart, we're going to live the journey of these mm-hmm. lives, that we might be on this path to be exactly as Christ would have
us. And this lines up with the election, or you could say the echoes of Israel here, about yep. them being holy as God is holy, being set apart. And really, it's you are holy because God is holy.
Yeah.
And that's a better translation of Leviticus.
Yep. So this whole thing, when it goes back and, you know, hits Leviticus and these different mm-hmm. things, it's talking about, you know, this grafted people, things like that. There's a lot of different plays, but it's a relationship of acknowledgement. It's being claimed, and then we're going to get into mm-hmm. the next part of that, which is sprinkled blood in obedience.
Yeah, and it's interesting here, it says that this whole thing, the election, the diaspora, the foreknowledge, all of that is for the purpose to obey Jesus. It doesn't say that these people were chosen for salvation, they were chosen to reflect Jesus, to
it
obey Jesus.
It all comes
Jesus.
To Jesus, yes.
Yeah. So it doesn't say they are chosen to go to some pie in the sky, some were chosen, some were passed over. No, it's like this group in Christ were chosen for the action of sanctification to become more like Jesus.
Dude, that's important because even today there's some that question that with Jesus. I just uh-huh. had this conversation yesterday. Was Jesus truly the Son of God? And that's again why he starts out with a strong Trinitarian statement, and then we're going to go from there, go back to a picture of Exodus 24 to mm-hmm. claim this.
Yep. The next thing we need to address kind of in this opening thing is it talks about sprinkled blood.
Yeah.
So and we went over this a lot. If you want more information, look at our atonement series. The sacrifice video especially talks about sprinkled blood, which I think is the second or third video in our yeah. atonement series. So yeah, like you said, Exodus 24, the sprinkled blood was the ceremony, the covenant ceremony at the base of Mount Sinai,
yep.
there when Israel and God entered into covenant together.
Now, this is one of those things that, like, some people just read right by, and I kind of step back and my mind just starts triggering. I go, how many people are we talking about? And so, you mm-hmm. know, you kind of hear, I've heard any numbers from 100,000 all the way up to 10 million people, and we do get some pictures. This doesn't matter, but I want to keep mm-hmm. us, you know, I want to work through everything here. And so how does this work that he sprinkles all these people? And so when I kind of do the math, I probably come up with about 1 million people, and that's really a reference. We've got at Sinai, we've got this number, which is crazy. Sometimes we get some very specific numbers in the Bible, and we've got 603,550 that we're given.
Mm-hmm.
Crazy that it's actually counted to
yeah.
that specific number. But that's just men. And so then you've got all women and children, and the boys until they reached about 12 years old wouldn't have been counted in that number too. So we've got 600,000. How many did that really mean? About 1 million. Maybe we're still only sprinkling the men. That would have been possible in
yeah.
Old Testament.
Mm-hmm.
Is this representative? In Exodus 18 and Exodus 24, we get a picture of the elders representing the whole camp of people. It's communal thinking, so that
yeah.
would have worked. So
uh-huh.
I've heard people kind of have a problem with this, saying there's no way, what does Moses have, like, these, you know, huge lawn sprinklers that he's going to sprinkle 1 million? How does he even talk to it? We get this idea that, you know, he's kind of having this talk with the people and they're responding. And, you know, I think this is our modern world thinking, that we think that everybody needs to respond. All 1 million people have to have a response to Moses. And that wasn't necessarily the case. But we don't know the specifics. We don't know if elders were representing all the people, if maybe they were sprinkled and then they, in a way, kind of brought that back to each, you know, smaller portion of the people. We don't know if there was, you know, supernatural work going on there. There's
mm-hmm.
all times, this is this is early Old Testament. It wouldn't have been unusual. I mean, we've got manna in Exodus 16 that's just falling out of the sky. We've got the pillar following the people in Exodus 13. I'm not ruling out a supernatural microphone and, you know, cosmic God sprinklers of blood. I think the main thing is to not get hung up on little stuff like that. But it's still important to address it, that this isn't entirely, you know, a weird thing in the Bible. We read these supernatural activities, and that's kind of where I lean towards this, is maybe it was slightly representative because Israel was communal.
Yep.
Maybe it wasn't. But all those thoughts are actually going to tie into the way that 1 Peter is going to now take these things and in the same shadow or way address them to the new covenant.
Yeah, and I think when we get to some ways that I think a lot of people go, when they hear sprinkled blood, they'll go right to like substitutionary atonement type thinking. But when we looked through our atonement series, we saw that sprinkling of blood, the only time here, it was to set aside people to be God's people,
yeah,
to live in the world as lights to the world. And whenever we saw sprinkling of blood in the sacrificial system, it was never sprinkled on people, except in this one ceremony. It was sprinkled among the articles in the temple for covering of sin, purging of sin, ritual detergent,
yeah,
we called it. So you can't go to this sin punishment type of thinking here. It's the point is he's setting people apart to be his people in this world.
Yeah.
Set apart from the world to be his kingdom, to be lights to the world.
And again, it seems like, I mean, obviously Hebrews 9:22 is the main thing that, mm-hmm, people want to go to, forgiveness of sins, of sprinkling of blood and things like that. And you get off when, mm-hmm, you start thinking that way. You got to think in terms of, again, we'll go back to our video and talk purification, yeah, sanctification. That's really what all of 1 Peter is talking about, is being a set apart, sanctified people. And, mm-hmm, so it's important that when he says this, it makes a reference going, mm-hmm, back to the original people were set apart to do this.
Yeah, and so then this connects back, the sprinkling of blood, to election. That's the background from this verse of being the chosen people in accordance with God's plan. They're sanctified, set apart by the Spirit and by the sprinkling of the blood to be people of the new covenant. And this connects to the whole story of Jesus's sacrifice and to the story of Israel and the covenant ceremony of obedience, and all of that goes together, which connects to eschatological blessings and to salvation as its benefits.
And even when I'd say the other side of the camp tries to take these verses and kind of show them as transgression for sin,
mm-hmm,
there's just a glimmer of truth in that when you get these New Testament allusions to it, what it's a reference to is Israel's sin that broke this relationship. So
yep,
it still is relational. It's,
yep,
it's not, the sprinkling of blood really doesn't have anything to do with the sin itself.
Yeah.
It has something to do with the transgressions of the relationship. And when you really, even in Hebrews 9, but a lot of these places, you're gonna get a word that means to overstep their boundaries. And that's, mm-hmm, what Israel was kind of guilty of doing,
yep,
was breaking the relational ties. So again, all of this language comes back to this idea of breaking representative relationships with God, you know, rather than this whole idea of trying to get some kind of fortune-telling foreknowledge out of this elect thing. Just, it doesn't fit here. You know, maybe,
yeah,
there's other places in the scripture that you can try to go back and get that, but everything here points to a relational aspect,
yep,
of covenant, and it's, mm-hmm, not dealing with anything else.
Yeah, and within that relational aspect of covenant, there is reassurance that you are God's people. So in your trials and suffering,
yeah,
that this audience is experiencing here in the diaspora, they can still have the assurance that they're God's people because of the work of Jesus and their reciprocal relationship through faith to him.
And again, this is so connected. I just love, mm-hmm, how it's so strategically interwoven, because from there, we're going to take what Matt just says, and he introduces this with grace and peace.
Yep, that's the
this
intro
is
to
so
his letter.
Beautiful. Grace and peace. Why is that beautiful? The word for grace is going to be kind of written to the everybody else audience.
Yep.
They all get that.
Yep.
And then you've got the next word, peace, which is a very Hebraic word. And so we see a grafting of different peoples going on
here. Yeah, charis was kind of a typical Greek greeting, which also is our word for grace or favor, a favor to you, I guess you could say.
And I got to say, he's talking about the dance of grace. That's what everybody would have been thinking when he's doing this, and he's mixing the word
relationships.
Grace and shalom together and saying, let's live in unity and relationship together here.
Good. So some application here is, in this introduction, Peter exhorts his audience to view themselves as exiles in society, that are defined as set apart for their obedience to Jesus and their Christoformity. They're displaying him to the world, but that's going to bring trials.
Yeah.
But they should have peace and joy within that.
And there's so many allusions to the different allegiance and, you know, rival kingdoms going on here, just in that exile language. And we didn't even really get into that, but if you watch any of our films, you know that's our mantra, and we would connect all of that kind of thinking to this as well.
All right, so let's move on. We're going to read 1 Peter 1, 3 through 12. We took up a lot of time on the first two verses. We'll fly a little quicker through this section. But
this is really a crazy thing. It might be, I'd have to check into this, but I believe this is the longest Greek sentence in the New Testament.
Yeah, it's pretty comparable with Ephesians chapter 1, where Paul does basically the same thing. The whole of Ephesians chapter 1 is one
sentence.
Don't
separate any of this. It's all together.
Yep.
So, Matt, you got to read this in one breath to do it justice.
All right. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy caused us to be born again into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you.
Are you tired yet? No. We just started here.
Yeah. Who are protected by the power of God through the faith for salvation to be revealed in the last time. It is in this you greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials, so that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold, which is perishable, even though tested through fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. And though you have not seen him, you love him, and though you do not see him now, you believe in him. You are greatly rejoiced with joy inexpressible and full of glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. As to this salvation, the prophets who prophesied of the grace that would come to you made careful searches and inquiries, seeking what person or time the Spirit of Christ within them was indicated as he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the glories to follow. It was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves but you, in which now you has been announced through those who preach the gospel to you and by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things which angels long to look into.
Now, I'm tired just listening to all that. I mean, there's so much in this, and we're going to dive into it. But again, like, this is in Greek, this is like one sentence. Mm-hmm. This is nuts. And so Even if you don't know any Greek, pull out an interlinear, just Google this in interlinear and look at it. It's just overwhelming to see this, the size of this. And again, it's strategically put this way. Mm-hmm. Peter doesn't want any reason to take this differently. He wants to make sure that it's all grouped and thought of together. So right away, he's going to continue with the relational language that he introduced already.
Yep, so he's got born again kind of kinship language. So verses like 2 and 3 both speak of God as a father, and Peter's communicating the concept of family and connecting that with being born again.
So we've got children, we've got brotherly love, born anew, parentage, which is like seed language, which is important to the New Testament, newborn babies, mature as children, household. Again, it's all this language that is going to be kind of grafted and setting the pace that you have to think intimately, relationally, in unity together.
Yeah, so in the Greco-Roman world and their culture of their family, it was an extremely tight-knit group. The pater familias is what they called it, was the father, the head of the household, the source of identity flowed from that person. And so he's saying here that our father the Father of Jesus Christ is the one who our identity as children, siblings along with Jesus Christ, our identity and our ethics and our morality flow from his source.
So this is something that is very important, and we don't often get this in our modern, you know, American mm-hmm. mindset, because it doesn't make sense. But this whole idea is called fictive kinship. And yeah. in the Greco-Roman Empire, if you had natural-born children, this is argumentative, somebody might say this, but you could just about kill them and get away with it, and it wasn't a big deal. Where if you adopted somebody, they were grafted in forever. You could mm-hmm. never cancel that relationship. Yep. And that's why when we get New Testament language that's talking about being, you know, sons and daughters of God being reclaimed, reborn, regrafted, it uses adoption language, because that was stronger than blood. And that's mm-hmm. also why I always go back to talking communally about the Old Testament, because that was a foreshadow of the type of family that this is supposed to be setting the tone for in unity, and why Matt and I look at this and we say, this is written to everybody, that all of them might understand. This is setting the tone for the unity of the church of believers. And Peter, the grand marshal of the church, is doing this here, saying this is relational. We need to be as family or even stronger than family. And the blood is actually important to claiming that.
Yep. And also in the honor shame societies, especially in the pagan thing, what the Christians are doing here are honorable within their household, even though it's dishonorable in the world. And right. so they're finding their source of honor based on their family ethos rather than the ethos of society. So that's one of the big things
here. So again, this is a little bit of a wordplay, backward kingdom thinking, contronym mm-hmm. language. In the Old Testament, this is represented as contratims that are in, you know, kind of stern work with each other. In the New Testament, it comes out as Jesus talking about backward kingdom. And this yep. is language that, again, is going to continue connecting the dots for people that might not get them in this audience to Jesus himself.
And the next thing, he says that Jesus is Lord here, which is basically meaning Caesar is not. It's yes. talking also not only about family language, but kingdom language.
Yeah.
So we got kingdom
strong
of God.
Strong allegiance.
Yep, strong yep. allegiance. And that's the big thing here. And that would have meant something to the Greco-Roman audience, who with the empire cult and all of that, especially, it would have been ringing in their ears whenever they heard Jesus is Lord. They would have heard, oh, Caesar is not. Don't participate in worshiping the empire.
Yeah. There's also a really interesting thing that he does here, contrasting sonship. He kind of mm-hmm. lumps together with parental status. And so it's a play on Jesus is God. And so mm-hmm. again, there's Trinitarian language going on here. But again, this is important, because a lot of people that were in this culture were still trying to necessarily figure out where they stood here. And mm-hmm. Peter is saying, get on the same page. This mm-hmm. this isn't a place of controversy. You need to be clearly here.
Yep. And next we need to look at born again. So he uses born again right at the beginning of this text that we read. And a lot of us, especially in the West, will ask, hey, are you born again?
Yeah.
Like a spiritual or ontological change. But that's not what they meant. It's really connected to the resurrection, to family. And Jesus talks the same way of Nicodemus in yeah. John chapter 3, where he says that you must be born again. He's talking about physical family relationship. Like, you're not saved just because you're a Jew. You need to be part of God's family,
yeah.
is the thing. We look at another text that we can see this language in is Joseph and Asenath, which was actually written, in the diaspora,
yeah.
and would have resonated with this audience, and they use the terms born again in Joseph and Asenath, which is the story of how Joseph, the patriarch, was marrying the son of this, or the daughter of this priest, and she had to become born again, basically become a Jew, so like a sister or a kin to him, so that she could be a rightful spouse to a Hebrew.
Yeah.
And so it's about family relationships rather than a spiritual or ontological change.
So let me just back up and clarify, because even though we've been a little scholarly here, I want to make sure that you get this mm-hmm. connection. So when he's talking about sprinkling blood on the people in the Old Testament, that's the only real reference we have to that. Every other time it's sprinkled on things and places to make them holy, never on people. And we, again, in our atonement video, we get really into this. But that's really important because it's going to identify these people as sacred space. And so it identifies them as sacred space. And then when you get here and he shifts and he starts talking about born again language, it's really important that you see that born-again language now as not a momentary line in the sand that you walk over and you say, now I'm saved, I just said this prayer in my head, and you know, everything has shifted in the cosmology of the universe, and I'm on this side of the line yet. The whole message of 1 Peter is that it's not a line in the sand.
It's a journey.
It's a journey of sanctification, and that you could be into this family, grafted in, you know, covered by the blood as you're chosen that way, but it's relational. It's not this crazy robotic thing from the beginning of time again. I know I sound like a broken record, but I'm just going off the text. If you read it the way that we read it, it continually reaffirms that kind of thinking.
Yep. So let's move on now to Peter talks about future salvation and inheritance and the resurrection. So he ties these themes together.
And again, the inheritance is going to go right off the last idea of adoption.
Yep.
You know, you have this sense of Greco-Roman, like you can't be thrown out type of thinking, and we're going to go right into inheritance.
Yeah. So it says the inheritance is imperishable, undefiled, and everlasting in the text, but it doesn't say what the inheritance is. It just describes the quality of the inheritance rather than what the quantity of it is.
So there's a reason why I stopped and said usually blood was sprinkled over things, usually sometimes land. Why? What does this mean? What's the significance?
Yeah, so in the land in the Old Testament was talked about as a gift to Israel, not necessarily their inheritance. Now that initially it was a gift, it kind of, you can see some inheritance language when it's passed on from father to son, or family to family, but and it talks about this also in Ephesians 1, but the inheritance there, when Paul talks about it, isn't defined either, what it is. So, and some believers think it's eternal life, others will think it's like renewed heavens and earth. We just don't know. It could be Jesus.
The Bible isn't actually clear about it, and this is why I get a little upset when people do the rote thing of, you know, the free gift of salvation, It's not that I disagree with that. I just think it's a poor hermeneutic translation to present it that way.
Yeah, salvation's kind of, I guess I can see it as this package, but we don't necessarily know until the end of what it actually is.
The words would be way more scripturally accurate to present the gift as land. That would make sense in the Bible, but people today would be like, well, where's my land? What do I get?
Yeah, so inheritance and salvation, it says in the text, are being kept in heaven for us. So pointing to that salvation is not heaven because it's being kept there.
It's actually
something.
Another contronym. It's like it's right in the face of don't think this way, yet everybody today thinks that way.
So heaven is usually an idiom for God's reign or God's presence.
Yeah.
And so salvation for Peter here is not simply present. It kind of talks about that a little, but it's a journey. It's something that requires growth, something that requires perseverance. It's not just saying a prayer and you're saved. It's something that's revealed here in the text at the last time.
Yeah, so, boy, this is really tough to get your hands. Again, get out of the stepping over the line thing. You're going to make your first allegiant decision, and that's just saying that my allegiance now is here. I'm part of this family. I'm going to be covered here and not over there, but those are fighting words of the day.
Yep.
All of a sudden, if you were going to take that first step, that means you're going to be disowned by everybody else. But again, that's just the first step. Yep. Now you have all of this, and I allude to this, that boy, when I look at, you know, this grafting of salvation and, you know, eternal life, and it gets into all kinds of eschatological thoughts of heaven and hell and everything else, it's not completed until, at the very earliest, the new heavens and earth and our new spiritual bodies. And so this is not just a work of sanctification within our lifetime, but it actually goes into most of heaven until the recreated heaven. How long is that? I have no idea.
No. Then it says that our faith is what protects us as we wait for salvation to be revealed.
And faith, again, we want to define as allegiance, obedient faith.
Yep.
The kind that would have gotten you killed to disclaim your allegiance in that time.
Yeah, so it's basically, it's when you put your allegiance with God, you are guarded by God's power, is really what it's talking about. And so this verse kind of gives fits to those who believe in once saved, always saved.
Right.
And so,
they don't know what to do with this one.
Salvation is a future thing, and we're guided by our, or we're guarded by our allegiance. So if you don't become allegiant, do you become unborn again? These are questions you need to think through.
And again, you know, we've never made a video on the once saved, always saved thing, but you probably read between the lines that that is a extremely tough biblical, theological stance to take. There's just too many places that are going to have a hard time with it, and this is one of them.
And so, like, salvation throughout the Bible is used in three tenses, and we've talked about this quite a bit. Most prominently and most popularly, it's used in the future tense, which is what Peter's using it here, and he uses it all throughout 1 Peter in the future tense. So in the past, we can talk about maybe conversion when we make a decision. In the present, it's our Christiformity, it's our sanctification, it's our being set apart, and in the future, it's whatever salvation is.
And the implication, in being that it's written in the future almost every time, is that none of us are quite there yet.
Yep. So if someone asked you, are you saved? He could say, well, I'm being saved.
I joke about that a lot. Yeah. People take it the wrong way. Are you saved? I'm not yet, but I'm getting there.
I'm being saved. Yeah. So let's get into verse 9 here. Verse 9 talks about the outcome of our faith as the salvation of our souls. So soul for Peter here isn't the immaterial part of your body. It's the Hebraic thought of the nephesh.
So this is going back to disembodied thinking. This is Stoicism. Mm-hmm. This is Platonic. Mm-hmm. That's directly in contrast with what he's saying. And again, it's strategically written that the audience listening to this would have known that he's speaking of the opposite. But again, my biggest problem with this is that he's being so strategic when you get into this to not say that. And then today, what do we all make it out to be?
Disembodied
heaven.
Yeah. So generally for Peter, all throughout his letter, he uses the word sarx to talk about living in the flesh or living in the world. But he talks about psuche or soul to talk about things that reflect to living as part of God's kingdom. Yep. So here he's talking about the salvation of who you are as a family member, as a part of the kingdom of God, as being born again into this family, as what soul means here. When he talks about someone as being in the sarx or in the flesh, he's talking about being part of the world, and he's contrasting those two ideas of behavior, ethos, ethics, the way you live as a kingdom person, Christiformity, all tie into those two words.
So salvation here, what he's alluding to is it's nephesh language. It's salvation that tells all of who you are, that all of you might be embodied. This is strong resurrection language. He's tying in. This is what Jesus accomplishes on the cross, that all of you together, individually and as the body of Christ, might bear the actual image of Jesus.
Yeah, and the big thing he talks about here in this chunk, you heard resurrection a few times. And so resurrection is being physically embodied and breathing.
Yeah.
And that's kind of the big idea that he has here, is the Christian hope is resurrection. It's not being disembodied in a soul state in heaven.
And as you read Peter and Paul, all of them, if you get this in your mind, and I earlier in the film I just listed a whole bunch of verses and challenged you to read them, but once you're to this place in mind, you can't read it any different way. All of Peter and Paul's, anytime their language gets eschatological at all, this is the way you think of it. I mean, if you're considering it a different way, you're going to run into problems in various different places of your theology.
Yeah, especially Paul in Romans 8 connects the future hope as the resurrection, and when the sons of God are revealed, talking of resurrection, then all creation will be released from its curse, from its bondage, from its decay. It's about recreated heavens and earth, and that's the big thing of the salvation that Paul points to, and Peter says the same thing.
So when we were researching in your notes, you had a quote by Joel Green.
Oh,
Matt and I talk, I don't know that we need to read it, but Matt and I talk a lot about this already not yet type of thing. And the idea is that we are to, as Christians, we are to think and act in the present like we're part of this new world, even though we're not quite there. It's not yet thinking. We are, but we aren't. It's this work in working.
Yeah, he talks about resurrection in Jewish literature, which signals the restoration of Israel is one thing, the vindication of God's righteousness, and the establishment of of God's purposes is divine justice. And it basically, because of Christ's resurrection, it should cause our imaginations to change about how we live. We should live as if the resurrection is now.
Yes.
So it's already not yet thinking, like you said, and that's really what he points to as he looks at resurrection in 1 Peter.
So we're halfway through this gigantic Greek sentence right now, and and he goes from there to kind of, you know, setting the pace for the way that we think, grafted in this family relationship. And then he talks about being tested of fire. And so we're at verses 6 and 7 here. And the idea that you might need to live out or even prove your faith.
Yeah, so it talks about metals being refined in fire. And so it burns off the dross. And pure. Some people take this as purifying, but if there's nothing good in you, do you get burned up, you know?
Boy, there are so many places we could go with this.
Yeah, go watch our health series.
But it does go back to, again, reference to the Old Testament of being sprinkled, being covered. Mm-hmm. This is sacred language again, yep, going into it, and, you know, being refined. What are you refined for? It's purification language that we need to be completely set apart as holy before, mm-hmm, the Lord.
I think he says is that the trials are what's purifying people. And yeah, we see this elsewhere. Paul uses the same language of that the trials produces perseverance and faith and all of this within us, and we see it.
And that makes joy. How does that work?
Yeah, so joy isn't, like we talked about, isn't based on our circumstances, but it's based on our love for Jesus and the future promises of this inheritance. It's having a, instead of a momentary circumstantial view of the way we live life, it's living that even these little things, these trials that come up, can't trip us up because of we know what's coming.
Yeah. So in your resurrected kingdom, you're going to have this sense of, even though there's trials and hardships and all this stuff, that we are going to find rejoicing in the true joy that comes out of being together in this, mm-hmm, intimate relationship, yep, with the Lord. And it's not so eschatological. That's the way most people make it, but there's actually joy here and now as well as joy in the future.
Yeah, so like really the thrust of these two verses is present trials may be greeted with joy since they are necessary for faith to be formed and proven character in God and producing the things that God will find acceptable at the final judgment. So he's talking about, in the past, Peter's audience were given new birth, and this is connected to relationship and parenting. In the future, when Jesus Christ is revealed, it says that it signals that these trials will cease and it will reveal salvation. But in the present, God is guarding you through faith, even though you're going through these trials. It's not the destruction of you.
So this is really important because you have a huge contingency of people that are worried. If we date this at 62 to 65, this is right before the Jews are annihilated in 70 AD. And so obviously the climate is building and they're worried. If I completely give my allegiance over to the Lord, am I going to be okay? Am I going to be protected? And part of 1 Peter's thinking here is that in the new kingdom thinking, you're going to be good. Mm-hmm. That might mean in the worldly setting, you're going to experience trials, or you might even die.
Yep.
But in the big picture of the new kingdom, that is joy in its essence, which is totally countercultural to the way that they were thinking in, you know, Platonic thinking, Stoicism, Gnosticism.
The next area that we need to hit on is prophecy and salvation history, is how Peter ends this sentence, this long sentence. And so the past was marked by prophets who looked, I guess, into the identity of the person or the character of the time in which the Messiah would come.
So again, this is the same language that we're going to be talking about the elect. It's that same relational language. It's not the kind of magic, you know, future foretelling.
Not Nostradamus.
It's going to be alive. So when you read this, a lot of people, unfortunately, read it that way. They want to read it with this, you know, prophetic sense of telling the future. And all of 1 Peter so far has starkly been in contrast to that kind of thinking.
Yeah, so when we look at the book of Revelation, I believe it defines prophecy for us. It says it is the testimony. Prophecy is the testimony of Jesus.
Yeah.
And so what points
to Jesus? Sufferings of the glories of the Messiah.
Yeah. So too often I think that we really put prophecy as simply predicting the future, and that's totally all that it is. Yep. But when you look at the prophets in the Old Testament, 95% of that was calling people back to faithful covenant living.
Yeah.
There was a bit of it that, yeah, did have futuristic type, but we see that all the promises are yes and amen in Christ.
And I always go back to your cup philosophy. Uh-huh. I think that's the best analogy.
So yeah, so if you got a cup that has water in it, let's say it's half full. What is true of that cup is that it has water in it. So there's nothing that's going to make that untrue. But if you pour more water in it and it's overflowing, it gives more meaning to the cup having water in it.
Yeah.
So when you see prophecies of Jesus, especially in the Old Testament, what the original context of that was true. But Jesus makes those things even more true.
Yeah.
He fulfills them. He fills the cup.
And our mantra of Christiformity is really because when we read all this stuff, it all points to Jesus.
Uh-huh.
You know, he kind of says this thing to the Pharisees that you guys are searching the scriptures for salvation. And again, like, if you don't take that as a poignant like point, don't make a line in the sand, I don't know what you would take that way. But
yeah,
but Jesus says it all points to me, a journey mm-hmm. with me.
Yeah, an example of this would be Matthew 2:15, where it says, out of Egypt I've called my son. When
yeah.
you look at Hosea 11:1, it has nothing to do with Jesus.
Right.
That's what he's right. quoting. And Matthew says it's a fulfillment of that. Is Matthew taking things out of context? No. It's not a one-to-one prediction type stuff, is the way prophecy always works. But they see, because of Jesus, they see him everywhere in the Old
yeah.
Testament. It's the Emmaus Road way of reading scripture, where
yeah.
Jesus tells them that all scripture points to me.
So towards the end of this set, in 1:11, we kind of get to this idea of the spirit of an agent of revelation.
Yeah, so through there we see that the Spirit was the one that identified and foretold, worked through these people to tell about the sufferings of the Messiah. And so Peter is thereby showing the continuity of the presence of the Holy Spirit in their lives, which he talks about in verse
yeah.
2, with the sufferings of the Messiah. He's tying their sufferings and Jesus' sufferings together in the whole story of Israel,
yeah.
Putting it all together.
So in the first film, we kind of said, what is this? Is it just to the, you know, Hebrews, as some people fight? To take that and go through what we've gone doesn't make any sense. Throughout
no.
this whole message, he's grafting things together. And now
mm-hmm.
he's kind of getting a little eschatological, and we're looking into his hermeneutic sense here, and we're seeing how he connects Old Testament and New Testament and tells the whole unified story for Jesus to come, that now all might be grafted in to
mm-hmm.
this family together.
Yeah, so what are some of the applications maybe for us as we wrap up today? So we're primarily Gentiles living
yeah.
in a post, I would say, a post-Christian nation.
Yeah.
And though basically, Peter's audience is being persecuted, our sufferings may not be as intense as theirs, but we still have the same social pressures that they might have
yeah.
to conform to the way of the world. So what Peter is really saying is that we need to look at ourselves as not parts of, not citizens of this world, not citizens of America, not citizens of Canada, not citizens of Israel, or
right.
whoever's watching, whatever country you're a citizen of. Our citizenship as believers, we're part of the family of God, part of the kingdom of God, and our allegiance needs to be to that far above anything else here on this world.
And boy, in America, we just do not think that
uh-huh,
way.
We're
That's
so tied into our nationalism.
So counterintuitive
mm-hmm.
to what Peter is teaching here. It's also this idea that we're, in the same sense, that we're all grafted into this family. And on my wall at home, I have this big poster that I made that pretty much says we're part of an ancient covenant all tied in together.
Yep.
And that's the language here. It's he's trying to get you to understand the magnitude of the inheritance, but also how serious this is.
Mm-hmm. And the next thing is Jesus is the hope of all the ancient and the modern eschatological hopes.
Yeah.
So it doesn't matter if you're an ancient person or a modern person, Jesus is the hope no matter what generation you live in.
And then as we've mentioned several times, there's this idea that if you were going to follow this
mm-hmm.
way, that you would be an outcast in the
yeah.
Greco-Roman society, that you would be nowhere. But in that backwards thinking,
mm-hmm.
what Peter is saying is that even though you're going to be considered nothing by everybody else, now you'll be great in the kingdom, as Jesus said, and now the first will be last.
Yeah, so yeah, the sufferings that we have here are actually honorable in the eyes of God, even though it looks dishonorable in the eyes of this world. Yeah.
And one of my favorite things about all of this is just how eloquently he ties this in. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's like a joke about the one sentence thing, but it's like this giant one sentence that just, you know, pulls the puzzle of all time together, grafting in this idea mm-hmm. of the church moving together as a body of inherited believers together.
Yeah, it's basically the service of the Spirit in us and from the Old Testament connects the past and the present, and it's all Christ-centered, and it and that forms us of how yeah. we should live our lives.
So, Matt, if I were just hearing this, this would probably be the majority of people listening to this, pastors, you know, even
lay people, whoever.
This is going to be totally new. I think that the normal person just reads 1 Peter and they don't get any of this stuff that we just went over. Most of it goes over their heads. So if I was sitting here, I would be having a few questions that kind of need to be answered. And so the first one would come down to salvation. What exactly does that mean? And what does 1 Peter imply here?
So I think that really, if 1 Peter implies a future salvation, then that we are preserved by our faith now. So yeah. it is an already not yet thing yep. that he puts forward. But primarily for Peter, he's saying that you need to walk this journey by faith to run the race well.
Yeah, and again, our mantra this year has really been on allegiance and belief systems, mm-hmm. you know, what we just talked about, contrasting, yeah. like, are you a patriot? What does that mean? Are you going to live for God's kingdom first or somebody else's? But that's mm-hmm. that's when you read this section of 1 Peter, you have to come to terms with that. Mm-hmm. You can't think about that any other way.
Yeah, and another question is, we don't hear resurrection talked about much in our Western churches,
right.
yet it's central to Peter's argument here at the beginning of the letter, is all yeah. the eschatological hopes hinge on the resurrection of Jesus.
Yep.
It's the same for Paul. It's all the New Testament writers hinge on the resurrection of Jesus. So I think resurrection preaching needs to get more a physical embodiment of a recreated heavens and earth rather than a disappearing
right.
to the pie in the sky, disembodied
exactly.
existence. It's just, you can't find that anywhere in the New Testament.
Yeah, and
it's Gnostic.
And with that, he's talking about huge trials right here. Again,
mm-hmm.
I brought out the point that
yeah.
like the reason we date this here is because it's right before the biggest mm-hmm. Jewish trials in history. I would even argue that this is going to be even more than their original exile. This mm-hmm. is, you know, the destruction of 70 AD and all the Jews have going. So he's preparing them for this kind of thinking, yet it's still relevant to where we are today.
Yeah, and especially in the what he's communicating, I think, to his audience here, and we talked about this a lot in our last video, and that's what he's going to launch into next is really in verse 13 and following is self-denial.
Yeah.
Really taking up your cross and following Jesus, living the life that Jesus did, which involved suffering and giving of yourselves and emptying of yourselves. And how hard is that in our American cultures today where we just strive on comfort?
Yeah, yeah. So that's going to be a good one.
Uh-huh.
I'm excited for that
yeah,
one.
Yeah, so that's next time.
I hope you got something out of this. This is actually one of my all-time favorite passages of Scripture. I think we probably could have made about 8 films just on, you know, this first part of 1 Peter. But I hope you got the new way of thinking. If you've never considered this kind of idea that 1 Peter is setting the tone for, it's not just 1 Peter, it's all of the New Testament. But this is probably the most concise, when you break this down, the most concise way of thinking of it together in that way.
Yeah. Well, thanks for joining us as we kicked off looking at the text here in 1 Peter. We're going to continue with Peter's thesis statement and how to basically live out that thesis as he begins his first argument after that. So thanks for joining us on this journey through 1 Peter. May God bless you and keep you.
We'd wrap up.